This morning, John chapter 4. If you don't have a Bible there, take one of the pew Bibles and turn with us, please. John chapter 4 is on page 912. Page 912, and we'll get into the message in just a moment. Well, we had a phenomenal week last week. Really good crowd. Our Sunday morning number was 205, and what a great morning. And then Sunday evening was 137. And so a great Sunday for us. Of course, Easter Sunday, typically have a spike in your attendance and folks that you don't typically see. So we're glad to be able to do that and have those extra people. But you know, I got to thinking how exciting it was last week to have a full house, that if we took that mentality of Easter every week, what the Lord could do. If we were conscious of asking people throughout the year, not just on Easter and Christmas, you know, to come to church and to be with us and to care for them and to invite them to come, you know, it could be life-changing for them and make a huge difference for the church. And say, so, well, you know, Easter and Christmas, everybody, you know, they know they're supposed to go on those days and it's kind of a big deal. So what do we invite them to, you know, on a normal Sunday? Well, that's where you come in. You and that individual that you're praying for, you know them, you know the needs in their life, you know how you've been praying for them, you know who they are, and so you can talk to them about the different things that, hey, maybe this, you know, sermon series is really going to particularly speak to them, and maybe they're going through something in their life that the Bible study we're talking about is hitting right on that. And so use those types of opportunities to invite people and to encourage them to come. Invite them to a class activity. Invite them just to be with you. Just be my guest this week. You know, I'd love to have you come to church with me. It's been a while. Things like that. But if we had that kind of mentality every single week, you know, what could God do if we had that in our heart every single week? And so I just wanted to challenge us. This morning in Sunday school, Brother Aaron, we're still kind of going through the book on Take It Personally that the rest of us went through. And I know we've all gone through different paces through that book. But we were talking about a prospect list this morning. And how that it's intentional. When you have a prospect list and you have people that you're praying for, that one card that's out there in the vestibule, you know, get one of those and write somebody's name on there that you're praying for and keep track of how many times you're speaking with them and inviting them. When we're intentional, things get done. You know, if we just make a vow or we say, yeah, we need to do that and move on, we're not really going to make it happen. But what gets scheduled gets done. And so maybe we need to be more proactive in that area of keeping track of the people that we're praying for and working on. So keep that in mind. Pray for them, invite them, and witness to them about the Lord Jesus and what he's done in your life. All right, well, on Sunday mornings, once again, we're talking about church words. And we've had a lot of fun talking about some of the lingo out and about and the words that are used and you know, different phrases that people use for things that leave us in the cold and in the dark, and we don't know particularly what they're talking about. But all of us have experienced from time to time a conversation where two or more people are talking about something we have no idea about. And they're using words that confuse us. We have no clue how to get involved. We couldn't contribute to the conversation if our life depended on it because they're talking about something that's foreign to us. And we've talked about several things, but here's another one that I think a lot of us can relate to. Now, there are some guys in the room this morning and probably some ladies as well who are going to think this is pretty funny about me, but I don't really know anything about cars, okay? And I know there's a lot of guys here who either have, you know, not nice old cars that they've taken care of and I don't even know the words to use. Classic, you know, antique. I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, you know. But, you know, these cars that they've restored or that I know Brother John's got a really cool car. I have no idea what year, make, model, but I know it's awesome, okay? And my brother-in-law, Don, do you still have the Chevelle or is that, he used to have a 69 Chevelle, right? And it was really cool. I remember the day. It had been sitting in his garage for years. And I remember the day that me and my buddy Chad Baker and him, we were out there, and he said, let's try to get this thing started. And we popped the clutch, and that thing, you know, started up, and it was growling, you know, and roaring, and we jumped in, and he probably went down the street there. It was 25 miles per hour. We didn't go near that. We were way over it. And we had a great time, and I know it was cool, but I don't know, you know, all the things about it. You could pop the hood. I can tell you where the battery is. I can tell you how to change the washer fluid. I can check the dipstick. But really, after that, I'm lost. Okay? We just recently had somebody was getting rid of a car, some friends we knew, and it was their daughter's car that she had driven, and it's a 2000 Civic, and they were going to give it away. And so we contacted him and said, hey, we got a daughter who's getting ready to drive. We'll take it. And so he gave it to us real nice. And so we took the car, and he said, there's only one known issue that you need to take care of. He said, you know, the part of the muffler that's connected to the catalytic converter to the rest of the muffler system, you need to get that fixed. And I was nodding my head. Okay. Making mental notes. I have no idea what any, I know what a muffler is, okay, because I know that there's lots of cars that don't have them, or at least sound like they don't. I know what that what it is and what it's supposed to do for the most part, but I don't know what a catalytic converter is. I have no idea. I know that people steal them, and I don't know why. And I know that the muffler connects to kind of keep the car quiet. And I was just making mental notes so I could tell my mechanic, listen, this is what needs to be done. And then he starts telling me, well, we'll have to check this, this, and this. And I'm going, uh-huh. You know, one of those, like, I have no idea. But yeah, man, I trust you, you know. And so I have no idea. Cars, you know, you're talking about this, that, or the other. Forget it. I'm out. I can change a tire, put gas in the car, and turn the lights on. That's about it, okay? But I know there's several people out here. You could talk circles around me about cars, but I'm lost completely. So, you know, these guys get excited about, oh, did you see his car, man? Oh, yeah, it's got this, that. Can't help you. I can't contribute other than saying, that looks cool, you know. So I'm out. It's big words. It's car words. I don't understand. I feel lost. I feel left out. And sometimes at church, we do the same things, don't we? We throw around church words that new people or young people might have no idea what we're talking about. And I don't say that to say don't use church words. I say that to say be careful about how we use them. Because like anything else, whether it's words or actions, anything that becomes ritual or habit or going through the motions is dangerous. Because it's what one time had value and meaning is now just thrown around and used frivolously. And so we need to be careful about how we use these words. Why do we do what we do? Why do we say what we say? And what does it really mean when we say it? So just clearing some of those things up this month. And the word for today is worship. Worship. And now there's a lot of ideas about what worship is and what worship isn't. And we're not going to exhaust the idea this morning, but I do hope through the Word of God we'll get an idea of what worship really is. And boy, you say that word, and in a lot of contexts, people will get tense and nervous because they're afraid that something might happen that they're not used to. And then in other contexts, you say worship, and then everybody feels free and excited and ready to go. Why is that? Why is there this difference in that word? Why does the word worship worry us? Or why is it for other people an exciting thing? And so let's get to the bottom of it today. Let's look at what the Word of God has to say about worship. You know, worship is simply expressing reverence to one worthy of great honor. That's what worship is. Expressing reverence to one worthy of great honor. So some kind of an expression of reverence to someone we feel has great honor and they're worthy of this type of worship. So that's what worship is, expressing reverence to one worthy of great honor. And the question for us this morning is this: am I truly a worshiper of Jesus Christ? Do I really worship? We call this our Sunday morning worship service. But am I, when I come in this room, when I'm here at church, when my body is physically present, am I worshiping? Do I worship in my car? Can I? When I'm out in walking the trails in Tennessee, can I worship there? Am I? What is worship? Today we're going to see the commands to worship and the ways that worship can be carried out according to the Word of God. So let's look here. John chapter 4, we'll begin in verse 19. This is the account of the woman at the well. We sang Fill My Cup this morning, and that first verse references the woman at the well. And so this is later on in that account. Jesus has already met her, already told her what he can do for her life. And so we're going to pick up in verse 19. John chapter 4, beginning in verse 19, and we'll read through verse 24. Okay? John 4, 19. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to be here again today. And we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the music that's already put our minds toward you. Lord, we thank you for each and every person that's here today. And Lord, now as we come to your holy word, we ask that you would do a work in our hearts and lives. Lord, we don't want to just go through the motions today. We don't just want to have, quote, a good service. Lord, we want you to really make a difference. Lord, I pray that through your Spirit and your Word that you would speak to our hearts. God, that you would convict us, that you would challenge us, that you would encourage us. If there's someone here this morning who's not saved, that today will be the day of their salvation. Lord, I pray that you would make what needs to happen in our hearts happen. Lord, help us to open our hearts and our minds to you, that we'd be willing to be obedient to whatever it is you say to us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so church words, this morning's word is worship. And so we saw here in this, just the snippet of this account between Jesus and the woman at the well, she is a Samaritan. And they worship in a different way and in a different place than the Jews worship. And Jesus is making that difference as he's talking here to her in verses 19 through 24. And he says, she says, I perceive you're a prophet, and this is how we worship. She tries to talk religion with Jesus. And Jesus says, listen, you all don't even know what you worship. But us Jews, we know what we worship. And there's coming a time, lady, where we worship is not what's going to matter. He says, and the hour now is that we're supposed to worship God in spirit and in truth. And this is a very important teaching on worship by the Lord Jesus. It's a part of an incredible account here, but it's a very important teaching on the subject of worship. And so we have to look at what Jesus has to say about it. And the first thing we notice that Jesus approaches here is the proper attitude in worship. What is the proper attitude in worship? Well, Jesus says in verse 23, notice this, but the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. So Jesus is speaking of the proper attitude in worship, worshiping the Father in spirit and in truth. What does that have to do with? Well, first of all, how do you worship in the Spirit? Now, Baptist, many times we get nervous when people say we're going to worship in spirit. Then we get nervous, you know. We begin, what's he going to do? What's she going to do? They said those magic words, worship in spirit. And that makes us nervous because there are other denominations that are very demonstrative in their worship. They lift hands, sometimes they run aisles, you know, they do extreme things. I'm not commenting this morning on whether we're right there, white, we're in between there. I'm not saying that this morning. I'm just giving the different types, okay? And so there are lots of ways that people are demonstrative, the ways that people show their worship, okay? And so when we begin to talk about that, especially as Baptists, we get nervous because we believe, and we've kind of been raised and taught, that we're quiet, we don't move, and we're proper, and you can say amen, and if you're a lady, you can wave a hanky, and that's it, you know, and we've kind of been brought up that way, and we're a little nervous about when people talk about expression or worship or spirit. And let me say this, the words expression, the word worship, and the word Spirit are great words. Listen, it's great to have a wife who helps you in every part of your life, okay? So thank the Lord for a great wife, and she gets the assist in preaching this morning, and we'll probably be nervous about that too, but it's okay. All right. Anyway, so those are great words. It is proper to worship, okay? The Spirit of God is incredible. He indwells all of us, so it's good, okay? And to worship in spirit is the proper way Jesus said to worship. So it shouldn't make us nervous. What it should make us do is say, okay, what does Jesus mean by that? And how can I properly worship according to what Jesus teaches? So what does it mean to worship first in spirit? Because he says true worshipers will worship in spirit and in truth. So number one, spirit. Well, only those regenerated by the Spirit of God can worship in spirit. You have to be born again. You have to be saved in order to worship in spirit. Because if the Holy Spirit of God is not in me, I can't properly worship God. Now, there are lots of unsaved people who are fond of God and are fans of God and would not be negative or nasty toward him. But that's not worship. Worship, first of all, it's going to be the proper kind of worship that Jesus is speaking about, must come from an individual who's born again, someone who has the Spirit of God indwelling in them. So only those regenerated by the Spirit of God can worship in spirit. Now, it's important because Jesus brought this up because in Judaism, Judaism is a religion that's all about the law, the letter of the law, and doing things the way they are laid out. And the Pharisees were so concerned about doing things properly, they even made up extra things to make sure that things were done in their mind the way they should be done properly. They made extra rules on top of God's rules to keep everybody kind of under the thumb, if you will. That's how the Pharisees worked. And Judaism is a religion all about the law. I'll never forget, out soul winning one night, I was going up in a neighborhood here north of Galbraith Road, and I walk up into a front yard, and there's some folks working in their yard, a man and his wife, and I began to ask if I could share the gospel, and they said, "We're Jews, we're Jewish." And I said, "Okay, wonderful." It was just at the time on Wednesday nights that I was teaching a series on the Jewish feast, so I felt, you know, equipped. And so we started talking about the Passover, and we went through all of that, and we talked about what we believe about that and the differences. And at one point, I was talking about Jesus and grace, and the lady, I'll never forget this, she looked right up at me, and she said, "It's so hard to keep the law." She was exhausted. She was almost like, "I give up. I try to keep the law, but it's almost impossible." And I transitioned that. I took her right to the word, and I said, "Yes, that's the point of the law. It's to show us that we can't possibly keep it." And so we talked about that a little bit, but I was trying to explain to her that, yes, the law is given for a purpose, to show us that we need a Savior because we can't possibly keep the law. But notice, Judaism is all about the law. It's all about rituals and ceremonies and sacrifices and feast days and Sabbaths and so forth and so on. It's all about the law. And Jesus is teaching here about worship. He says worship is not about form and rite. It's about the attitude of the heart. Having the right spirit. Fake worship is wearing the right clothes, saying the right things, acting the right way, and having a heart far from God. That's fake worship. That is not worship in spirit. That is, I am dressed the right way, I am acting the right way, I am saying the right things, so I must be worshiping. And Jesus says, no. You have to worship in spirit. The attitude of the heart. Our heart, if it's not right with God when we come into this room and we stand and we sing that hymn at the top of our lungs, if our heart's not in it, that's not worship. We're just singing. Our heart is what matters when it comes to worship. Is our heart proper? Do we have the right attitude of our heart toward God? Do we come into church today seeking to really connect with God, or did I come in here today seeking to do what I do every week and just sing and listen and go home? That's the idea here. And only me and God know that about me. And only you and God know that about you. And we don't need to get into a judging match of over, well, his heart's not right. Only you and God know that. Only me and God know about me, okay? But we have to be concerned about our heart's attitude, because the Pharisees were really good at doing all the right things, but they weren't close to God in their heart. Worshiping in truth does not have to do with the right manners or forms. It has to do with the right object in worship. So worshiping in spirit is having the right attitude and the right heart. And then Jesus says they need to worship in truth. And worshiping in truth has nothing to do with doing it. Now listen carefully, because you all understand that we're for the Word of God and for the truth of the Word of God and for the inspiration and the inerrancy and the preservation of the Word of God. We're all for that. We all believe we need to follow the Word of God. But worshiping in truth does not have to do with manners or forms. Worshiping in truth has to do with worshiping the correct object. Look at the context of John chapter 4. When Jesus speaks of worshiping in truth, he's talking about worshiping the Father. Notice his words to the woman at the well. Verse 22, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. He's not talking about doing it the right way now. He's talking about who you're worshiping. And he says to her, you all worship, but you don't have any idea who or what you're worshiping. At least the Jews know who they're worshiping, he says, because salvation is of the Jews, speaking of himself. Now note, this is context. This isn't my opinion. This is context of what Jesus is talking about. Worshiping in truth is worshiping the right object. Jesus tells her she's a Samaritan and she doesn't really know what she's worshiping. True worship, worshiping in truth, is directed to the right person, the right God. Jehovah God, the Lord Jesus Christ, is where our worship ought to be directed. Our worship may be heartfelt, but if it is directed at anything or anyone other than the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not true worship. That's why there's a lot of sincere religious people out there who may have a right heart in their worship, but they're directing it in a wrong direction. They're worshiping a false god, or they're worshiping, get this, their tradition. Do you remember the Old Testament, the Israelites, when they worshiped the brazen serpent? The tool that was used to save those people from their snake bites, and they began to worship the tool instead of God? And what did Moses do with it? He broke it up and showed them that it was just an object, that it did not save them, and that it cannot save them. And we need to be reminded, especially, you know, in our denomination, that our traditions do not save us. We don't worship our traditions. We worship Jesus. And unfortunately, there's been a drive that has led to a lot of people worshiping maybe their church, their denomination, maybe their church building. They worship a lot of things, but their heart is not directed at the Lord at all. And so to worship in spirit is to worship with the right attitude and heart. To worship in truth is to worship God. To worship God. You know what that means? That means I could worship on the trail in Gatlinburg, because it doesn't have to do with being in a place or directing it in a certain direction. It has to do with, is my worship toward God? Is my heart right? And is the object of my worship right? That's what it comes down to. You know, so many times we want someone to give us a listing of A, B, and C, and if you do these things in this order, you will be right. Because that makes it easy. That takes the brain out of it. That really just takes all accountability out of it. If I just do this because so-and-so said to do this, then I'm right. And then we can check the box, right? Everybody's talking about checking boxes. We could check the box if that's the case. But that's where we need to be careful. We're not just here to check a box this morning. We're here to connect with the Creator. We're here to connect with God Almighty who saved our souls. And so that is true worship, having the right heart attitude and directing it toward God. Worship is expressing reverence to one worthy of great honor. Am I truly a worshiper of Jesus Christ? Next, let's notice the proper approaches to worship. Now, this is the fun part here. This is the fun part we like to talk about. What are the proper approaches to worship? You know, when we talk about worship, it's often associated with music, isn't it? I mean, there's a whole genre of music called praise and worship music. And nothing wrong with praise and worship music. Absolutely nothing. In fact, there's a lot right with praise and worship music. The book of Psalms is a whole book of praise and worship music. It's about praising God and worshiping Him from our hearts. That's a wonderful thing. Nothing wrong with praise and worship. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Okay. And if you disagree with that, your heart is cold this morning. I'm not playing games. That's a fact. Nothing wrong with praise and worship music. There's a lot wrong with the way people do some of it. But there's nothing wrong with praise and worship music directed toward God. So we see here, a lot of times, when we talk about worship, music automatically comes to mind. Also emotion. When we hear the word worship, we think of emotion. And we've seen the extremes on that, haven't we? We've seen people running up and down aisles. We've seen people jumping all over the... It's often associated with emotion. We've also heard that worship is associated with demonstrative actions. These things, listen very carefully, these things can be part of worship. I know there's one instance, I understand that, but there is an instance in the Word of God where David danced before the Lord. And because his wife despised him for it, she was barren. Now, I'm telling you right now, first of all, I can't dance, okay? I just can't. I look like a three-legged giraffe if I try to dance, okay? It's bad. You're not going to catch me dancing around, okay? And I know that makes a lot of people happy this morning, including my wife and me and my children. But listen, if somebody is excited in the Lord, and I'm not saying run, I can feel the room getting tense right now. I really can. I'm not saying we should run up and if it's, if it's all about people looking at me, it's wrong. Because worship has nothing to do with me. It's everything to do with God. But if God speaks to my heart and I put my hand up or, man, I jump, you've seen me do that before, right? If it's directed toward the Lord, that's between me and the Lord. And when we look at someone and condemn them in our heart, you know what that's called? That's called quenching the Spirit of God. So we need to be very careful. Now, music, emotion, demonstrative actions, they can be a part of worship. But listen carefully. When we read of those things in Scripture now, they are a part of the context. A part of the context. Not the whole or not even a majority of the context of worship. Whenever we read of those things, it's not all about that. It's about worshiping God, and they can be a part of worship. Okay? Now, what is worship rarely associated with? Unfortunately, it's rarely associated with the things that it's supposed to be associated with. Let's look at what the Word of God has to say. Turn with me to Deuteronomy 26. Deuteronomy 26, page 193 in the Pew Bible. Deuteronomy 26. Now, we just talked about this subject recently, so I promise you I'm not going to go into this deep. But we have to mention it because it's in the Word. Deuteronomy 26:10. Deuteronomy 26:10 says, "And now, behold, I have brought the first fruits of the land which thou, O Lord, hast given me. And thou shalt set it before the Lord thy God and worship before the Lord thy God." It has to do with an offering. How can I worship God with an offering? Let's go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 2. Page 822 in the Pew Bible. Matthew chapter 2. We can worship God with an offering. Matthew chapter 2, 8:22 in the Pew Bible, verse 11. This is talking about the wise men coming to see Jesus. Matthew 2:11 says, "And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh." Brothers and sisters, right there in verse 11, an act of worship is bringing an offering to God. Now, like I said, we've talked about that. I'm not going to linger there. But you know, that's why when I say on Sunday mornings, and at this time we're going to have the ushers come forward as we prepare to worship the Lord with our tithes, and that's why we say that. Because that's an act of worship, to give God an offering, to give God back of what he's given to us. So that's one way we can worship God, with our tithes and offerings. Next, right there in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11. Did you see something else in there, an act of worship? Look what it says. "And when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshipped him." You know, sometimes an act of worship is bowing, kneeling, or humbling yourself in God's presence. That can be an act of worship. Showing from your heart, even through your body. Remember, worship is expressing. You can bow, you can kneel, and showing humble reverence to God. That's one way we can worship. Turn over just a few pages to Matthew 28. We'll see another instance of that. Matthew 28, verse 9. That was at the beginning of Jesus' life. This is after Jesus' resurrection. Matthew 28:9. This is speaking of his, it says, "And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by his feet and worshipped him." Listen, you don't hold somebody by their feet standing up, you know. They were down on their knees. They were worshiping, prostrating themselves, humbling themselves before God. That's one way we can worship, physically or mentally, spiritually, from the heart, humbling ourselves, showing that by our posture. When was the last time you saw somebody kneel down and worship? Been a long time, hasn't it? But that's a proper way to worship. Turn over to Psalm 95. Psalm 95, page 542. Psalm 95, page 542, verse 6. Psalm 95, 6. It says, "O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker." Humbling ourselves. And listen, brothers and sisters, the Bible says someday every knee will bow. And every tongue will confess. So let me say this. I don't understand why we feel like it's wrong to kneel before God, to humble ourselves and bow down before God, when someday the Bible says we're all going to do it. Wouldn't you rather do it out of a heart of willingness now than when we're forced to? Than when everybody will be told to bow and kneel before the Lord? Kneel before him. Bow before him. That is one way we can worship. Here's another way. Turn to Luke 24. Luke 24. How else can we worship? Page 908. Luke 24, page 908. This is again after Jesus' resurrection. He's saying goodbye to his disciples as he's getting ready to ascend into heaven. Luke 24, 52. He's carried up into heaven, verse 51 says, verse 52, "And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple praising and blessing God. Amen." Right there we see in verses 52 and 53, worship and praise. As he ascended into heaven, his disciples worshipped him. And they had hearts full of joy and they went back and they praised him. That's the way it ought to be. And these men who knew Jesus, and as he ascended, listen, here's another way we can worship God, by being in awe of his power. As he ascended into heaven, they were in awe of his power and they worshiped him. Has God ever done anything powerful in your life? Well, if you're saved, that's one big thing. And then listen to all the prayer requests that he answers for us. We've seen God's power. We've seen God work in our life. Do we worship him when he does? Being in awe of his power. Here's another way. Back to Matthew 14. Matthew 14. Page 835. Matthew 14. How else can we worship? What does it look like according to the Bible? Matthew 14. Verse 33. Matthew 14:33 says, "Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, thou art the Son of God." You know what they did? You know how they worshiped Jesus? By confessing his deity. That's a way we can worship the Lord Jesus, by confessing that he is God, that he is God's Son. That's an act of worship. It says they were in the ship, came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, thou art the Son of God. See, we don't think of worship in these terms. Our culture has so taught us that worship must be some type of emotion, music, and demonstrative action. Those can be a part of it. But worship, according to the Word of God, is very much a heart issue and a being directed in the right way and in the right object issue. And the ways that we can do that vary. Confessing his deity. We were on a soul winning this past week, and we met with a fellow who said, do you all believe in spirits? And we said, we believe in the Holy Spirit. And he started saying things. He said, I went to a church one time like yours, and they were talking about Jesus. I'm not all about Jesus, he said. He said, I'm about God, but I'm not about Jesus. And he started talking about spirits that he's seen in his house and all these things. And he kept downplaying Jesus. And every time we got a chance, we would say, sir, we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and is God himself. We said it 3 or 4 times. Why? Because that's what's important. And if you don't believe that, the Bible says it's the spirit of Antichrist. And so we over and over witnessed to this man that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that Jesus Christ is God. Did you know we were worshiping in that moment? According to the Word of God. Confessing his deity. And finally this morning, one other way we can worship, turn to 1 Chronicles 16. 1 Chronicles, that's page 395 in the Pew Bible. 395. Now this one here, this one here will show us how different our ideas are of what worship really is many times. 1 Chronicles 16, verse 29. It says, Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Notice this, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. You know, one of the best ways we can worship God is with a holy life. I won't take the time to turn there, but there are 2 other places it mentions this. Psalm 29:2 and Psalm 96:9. They both also say, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. You know what that tells me? This is a very convicting thought for us this morning. If my life 6 days a week looks one way, and I come in here and try to look another way, and I say that I'm worshiping, I'm not. That's called hypocrisy. Because the one way I can worship is with a beautiful, holy life. Holiness worships God. How? Because it demonstrates that we're obedient to him on our daily walk. A holy life. See, we don't think about these things. This is what the Bible says worship is. These are ways to worship according to the Word of God. And I wonder this morning, this question. After seeing this in the Word, am I truly a worshiper of Jesus Christ? If you'd stand with me, please, and our musicians would come. Everything begins. Everything in the spiritual life, everything with God begins with a personal relationship with Jesus. It all starts there. If you're here today and you are not in a personal relationship with Jesus, you have never asked Jesus to be your Savior. That's where everything starts. Would you start there today? You know, worshiping doesn't matter if we're not one of God's, if we're not His. So if you're here today and you're not saved, that's the first step you need to make. Would you do that? In just a few minutes, these folks are going to sing and I'll be standing right here. And you can come forward and say, Brother Phil, I need to know how to be saved. I'm not saved. I'm not sure I'm going to heaven. And we'll take the Word of God and show you how you can put your faith in Jesus as your Savior. If you're here today and you are saved, the majority of us, I would assume today, are. Interesting question this morning. Am I really a worshiper of Jesus? According to what the Word says, am I really a worshiper? Do I give Him lip service? Do I go through the motions every Sunday or every time we meet? Even in my personal study and devotion time, is it just kind of the routine? Or is my heart in it? Am I directing with the right attitude? Am I connecting with God? And am I worshiping God and not something else? This morning, as we consider what the Word of God has said, and as the Holy Spirit has spoken to our hearts, are we truly worshipers? As God speaks to us this morning, let's do business with Him.